Welcome to Don't You Forget About Me, great music moments in the John Hughes movies. We're here to discuss John Hughes movies, so don't know if really much of you guys saw those growing up.
Maybe. Who saw the movies in the theaters when they were in their youngster days?
Right.
That's about half an hour.
Yeah, good. So,
did you ever see them?
I did. I saw most of them in the theaters. There's a couple of years where I was out doing the work, as I like to refer to it, okay. Where I had to resort to VHS tapes at that point.
All right. So,
who are you?
My name's Steve Lentz. I'm a big '80s new wave nerd.
I'm Trent Fordham. I'm an '80s new wave nerd and movie fanatic, and wasted my 20s in film school. I didn't do anything with it.
I am by far the least qualified person on this panel. I am Sean Dahl, and I'm just a new wave music geek. So.
This is our first panel ever, so bear with us. So I think I gave pretty much everybody a ticket for our giveaway at the end. Does anybody not have one? Okay.
While he's doing that, just to kind of set the tone of the panel, we've got a brief video intro hearing from John Hughes, just kind of his thought process, how he went about choosing the artist for his song or soundtracks. We also have a brief video clip from the guys from OMD, and then a little video montage to kind of reset everyone's memory of the John Hughes movies.
I don't look at the album as a marketing tool. So I think if you do that, then you're going to fail, because it's really betraying the music. I mean, when I approach a band, I want to respect them and be respectful of their music. I'm not going to say, look, you guys are real hot, so we'll stick you in the movie and we'll get at all these stores and on all these stations. You know, that isn't right. Simple Minds worked for The Breakfast Club. In the context of the film, if you never bought the record, it wasn't intended to be. You know, we didn't put the song in there to sell records. Put the song in there because it was a part of the movie. You couldn't take that song out of the movie. You couldn't take the movie out of the song. And that's what I try to do. Not sell the records. It's arguable whether or not a hit song is going to make add to the business a film does. I don't know. I mean, there's plenty of films that didn't do any business and sold a million albums.
I think particularly his, what you know, called the Brat Pack movies, they were scripted with characters who were kind of outsiders.
Yeah.
You know, they were high school geeks and the outsiders and the alternatives. And I think it was quite logical that Hughes's kind of Anglophile taste in music, that alternative European music, would be the sort of music that those kids were listening to. So it made sense that he was asking mostly British bands, it seemed to equate to the characters in the movie.
His wardrobe.
And you just mind your P's and Q's, Buster, and remember who you're dealing with.
Oh, sexy girlfriend!
Do you have a kiss for Daddy?
Are you kidding?
You know, you're talking like that just because I'm going out with Blaine.
Blaine? His name is Blaine? Oh, that's a major appliance. That's not a name.
Where is my automobile?
Automobile?
So before we get started, I noticed that a few other people came in. We are doing a giveaway at the end, and so we have tickets. And before we do that, I'll make sure that whoever came in gets a ticket.
All right, so we'll start probably with the first one of John Hughes' first high school movies, 16 Candles.
1984.
So 16 Candles, looking back, listening to it, to me there's a lot of memorable music from the soundtrack. Did anybody have the original soundtrack?
The original, original?
Yes, sir, on cassette.
Oh, boy.
Oh. All whopping five songs.
All five songs.
All five songs.
Yeah. All five songs.
And I bought it for $10 at Ben Franklin.
Wow. $10 for a cassette? Wow.
So,
but as you can see up on the screen there, there was one song by Amy Golden? No, Annie Golden. Whoever that is. There's a Stray Cats, there's a Patti Smith, there's a just a music segment from Ira Newborn that was just music. And then of course
If You Were Here.
If You Were Here from the Thompson Twins. So four songs in one musical moment.
It was interesting because 1984 was my quintessential year for music and for my adolescence. And when I saw this movie, it was just song after song after song. And then when I went to the record store to buy the soundtrack and I saw that, I literally did not buy it.
Oh.
Out of protest.
Yeah, there was almost no point.
So I've never actually even owned it.
So Steve's brought up the next slide, which is actually the number of songs that were in the movie. And clearly a lot of very familiar songs. Really, if you get down to it, about 1984 and before, they really didn't release a lot of soundtracks. It just wasn't a thing. You didn't release soundtracks. And so, obviously, the first one that they put out for 16 Candles was just a couple of little songs and everything. Whereas they could have capitalized on that greatly with any, you know, 10 at least of these songs that were, many of them are just classics now.
One that's off, that was missing off that soundtrack was Spandau Ballet. They had their big hit, True, that made the appearance in John Hughes.
It was kind of the premiere of it, sort of?
Or had it was the first one in the album.
Oh.
Or soundtrack.
Oh, the soundtrack.
Wise, right before the album hit or right when the album hit.
Yeah, so it was before their actual album came out.
So that kind of set the tone for the awkward high school dance, slow dance songs going forward.
That reminds me of high school.
But the other big one on the soundtrack had to have been the Thompson Twins, If You Were Here.
Right, and that's clearly the pinnacle of that early soundtrack, that five-song soundtrack.
Kind of started with Hughes's, where he'd use the big song at the end to kind of make the big memorable moment. Everyone kind of remembers waiting for Jake to pick her up. Song and the iconic moment of 16 Candles sitting on the glass table that must be obsessively strong.
Yeah, I don't know if there's maybe a more iconic or important moment in teen film than that shot right there. I mean, everybody knows that. Maybe it's Say Anything with holding up the boombox, but that probably comes pretty close to one of the most iconic scenes in a teen-related kind of movie.
And then John Hughes' probably big one was The Breakfast Club. Everyone kind of really familiar with Don't You Forget About Me.
That was, what, 1985, a year later.
85. Much like 16 Candles, or the soundtrack is kind of slim pickings.
Very, very.
This actually is my least favorite of the John Hughes movie soundtracks that were made available. And part of it had to do with the fact there was just a bunch of incidental instrumental music, and I never even did buy it just because I looked at it and I was like, no, I don't need that.
Of course, that was back in the days. Well, you still do it now, but back in the days when you could just buy singles all the time. And of course, one of the biggest songs they ever in one of the films that he's had.
Yeah. Before that one probably was, when we're getting this prepped, Sean pointed out one of the songs is done by
Elizabeth Daly.
Yeah. Oh,
I think that's her name. A little bit of trivia if you want to entertain your family and friends around the dinner table. Elizabeth Daly, she also went by the name E.G. Daly, and she recorded a song for the movie Better Off Dead, which I'm assuming many of you would probably know that movie too.
Where's my $2?
Even though it wasn't a John Hughes movie, I think she did the title track. But the most interesting piece of trivia is the fact that Elizabeth Daly played Dottie in the movie Pee Wee's Big Adventure.
And also did at least some of the voices for Rugrats. So yeah, she's done. I never knew she was a singer until we started talking about it.
She was a pivotal part of the 80s, but nobody knows her by name.
So before we get to the big hit, the other semi-big one on here was right again right before they kind of burst through their bubble in the U.S. was Wing Chun. So most people are very familiar probably with Everybody Have Fun Tonight, To Live and Die in L.A., Dance Hall Days. And then their other hit for this soundtrack was Fire Through the Twilight. Might not really ring a bell, but it might remember the scene where they're running through the hallways from the Prince of Wales. So that might have been the breakthrough single if it wasn't for the big hit, Don't You Forget About Me.
Yeah.
Which surprisingly went through, was written, but and went to a lot of different artists before ultimately landing with Simple Minds. Originally it was presented to Brian Ferry of Roxy Music. He declined it. It then went on to Billy Idol. He declined it. Then to Cy Cerin from The Fix. He also declined it. Eventually, it landed to Chrissy Hynde and Jim Kerr. At the time they were married, Chrissy Hynde, the lead singer of The Pretenders, convinced Jim Kerr to take the song, even though they didn't write it. So Simple Minds took that song and rewrote it. Not really wrote, but they added like a little bit to make it their own, the fa-la-la-la verses and chorus. To the fact so much that when Hughes heard the final song, he actually really liked it and played it. It both opens the movie and closes the movie.
Well, and it's actually, I think, in there a few other times too, kind of just in the background. I mean, they really utilized that song for that film. I mean, it was the single.
And it was a huge, huge thing for that band particularly, because although they had some alternative, you know, we call them, you know, modern music hits back in the early 80s, that song broke them into the top 40, into the mainstream. It's still a song that's played on the radio today. Okay. And it launched them into superstardom for several years following the release of it. So
it was a huge hit for them. Huge.
Shows the power of music and what it can do.
And not only that, it also kind of helped make an iconic moment in The Breakfast Club. I don't think the ending would have been as iconic without the music undertone and the voiceover and then the chorus at the end and the memento or the nostalgia, fist in the air.
Mr. Burns. We accept the fact that we had to sacrifice a whole Saturday in detention for whatever it was we did wrong. But we think you're crazy to make us write an essay telling you who we think we are. And you see us as you want to see us. In the simplest terms, with the most convenient definitions. But what we found out is that each one of us is a brain.
And an athlete.
And a basket case.
A princess.
And a criminal.
Does that answer your question? Sincerely yours, The Breakfast Club. Don't.
Yeah, so, I mean, my kids don't really know those movies. They thought that, oh, this is like the what they did on the Goldbergs. Well, it's actually been way before them. So.
Oh, boy.
So, move on to Hughes's probably...
It's my least favorite of the Hughes films. I like the music in it, but I tell you, this film is so dated, and it ain't no Me Too movement movie. I tell you, I watched it again in preparation for this, and I struggled. I didn't find anything funny about it or anything.
I don't even think I've seen it all the way through.
So,
but it does have some great music.
So probably the most memorable on this one comes from the band Oingo Boingo.
Still touring, but without Danny Elfman.
So that song kind of became Boingo's probably second most popular song at the time, right before right under Dead Man's Party. Interesting about it, when we were preparing for this panel, we found out that song was actually written from Elfman after he got a phone call from John Hughes about the pitch of the movie. He wrote the whole song kind of in his head within 45 minutes on his drive home to go back and make a demo. So. Definitely a talented individual to do that.
Absolutely.
Refresh you from what it sounds like. Great song.
Love that song.
But the song does have a little bit of history. As we were kind of doing research from it, found everything that the band hated the song, they refused to play it live. And they did really, as Oingo Boingo, very rarely played that live. The reason the band hated the song as much is the record company actually turned in their demo to the studio for this use on the soundtrack. So they felt it was unfinished. When the Dead Man's Party album came out, they went back and retweaked it, made it their own.
And then it became, you know, hugely popular. And seriously, they still tour as most of the band, but with a different lead singer. And they come here pretty regularly. If you have a chance to see them, incredibly good show still. I mean, they are tight.
If you closed your eyes, you wouldn't even know you weren't listening to them.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah,
that's how good the singer is.
Yeah, the singer is just awesome.
He definitely channels a young Danny Elfman. And they put together, I think last time they played like an 8-minute version of Weird Science, which was pretty good.
Yeah.
So... which leads from Weird Science to probably John Hughes' biggest movie, Pretty in Pink.
Who doesn't love Pretty in Pink?
So, Pretty in Pink to me had a pretty monumental soundtrack. Definitely started getting me into a lot of the other bands in there.
We were just speaking to each other about the fact that on the soundtrack, probably the best soundtrack from start to finish, but they had to put on that bad cover version of...
Hold on to that.
So, Pretty in Pink, I think most people have probably seen that as well. One of the song we're referring to is Wouldn't It Be Good by Nick Kershaw. Instead, they do a... we'll kind of go into the video montage role. Instead, they kind of go into a cover.
So this is done by Nick Kershaw originally, but this one is actually done by Danny Hutton Hitters. And if you don't know who Danny Hutton is, he was the lead singer of Three Dog Night, strangely enough.
Just because I'm not a fan, we're not really fans of his voice.
The vocals. Past that. Sure if this song was on anything but the soundtrack. I don't know if it was on.
It
was not on one of her albums.
No, it's actually a collaboration with Joe Jackson.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, that's not piano. Yeah.
love can make a good man turn bad. So please, 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 let me, let me, let me.
Remember this song for a little bit later.
Get what I want.
How could you ever forget this song?
Time.
So some pretty big ones on the soundtrack, but there's obviously a couple bigger ones. But before we get to that, we're going to kind of cover the influence Molly Ringwald had on John Hughes. She was a big music fanatic. One of the bands she really was into at the time and made it well known in the movies, 16 Candles, Pretty in Pink, was the Rave Ups.
Who's heard of the Rave Ups?
Handful.
Okay. Couple people.
So the Rave Ups, she had their posters up, written on her binders for the couple of the movies, and then convinced John Hughes to let him have a brief. And when I mean brief, it's a brief moment in Pretty in Pink. So.
Kind of a cow punk,
yeah,
kind of sound.
But she also was a key into introducing John Hughes to the psychedelic furs. They had a song on their album, Talk, 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 called Pretty in Pink.
What?
So she introduced John Hughes to that song. He listened to it. He really liked the song, what he heard, and that's what he formed the title from. And just to refresh, if it's been a while since you've heard it.
All of our lovers all talk of the notes and the flowers that they never send. Wasn't she easy? Isn't she pretty and thin? One who insists he was first in the line is the last to remember her name. He's walking around in this dress that she wore. She's gone with the jokes the same. Pretty in thin. Isn't she pretty?
So, I think most of you guys probably all heard that song before.
A couple of times?
A few times. Again, this is one of those that kind of have a little bit of a history with the John Hughes movies. Simple Minds has kind of gone on a couple interviews. Or sorry, Psychedelic Furs, wrong band. Has kind of begrudgingly grown to hate that song that they play. It's one that they feel like they have to play at every concert because people want to hear the hits. Reason they don't really like it as much as they heard John Hughes just heard the song and not really listened to what the lyrics were. Kind of went back to that, and this is something I found out for this panel. I really didn't pay attention for 30 years, but the song Pretty in Pink is actually a metaphor for the girl sleeping around.
Wasn't she easy? Wasn't she pretty in pink?
So can kind of see where they're coming from, or wasn't the poppy little high school. It'd be definitely a dark high school movie.
Well, and definitely on the original album, I don't know if you had Talk, Talk, Talk from Psychedelic Furs. It's much more of a raw song, you know. It's definitely popped up for the movie soundtrack.
They did go back and pop it. And
yeah. It's much more of a kind of punk sounding song from that album, which is early 80s.
But surprisingly, that wasn't the biggest hit on the soundtrack.
No, it wasn't.
The big one that the studio released was If You Leave by OMD. So, I'm going to let you.
All right, so originally, If You Leave, obviously, it was a huge hit for the band and a huge hit on the soundtrack. But originally, it was supposed to be a song called Goddess of Love, which ended up being on their album after the soundtrack came out. And it's a great song and everything, but they're one fun thing that we had the privilege, Steve and I did, of when OMD was just here in concert a couple of weeks ago, we went and interviewed them, and we're not going to show you the whole interview, it was like 40 minutes long, but we've got a little truncated version of it here to give you a little bit more history of that song and its use in the soundtrack.
So then we flew to Los Angeles, and we were with our tape of Goddess of Love to mix it. We had 2 days off before like a 2 month American tour. And so we thought, well, we just went to mix it and see John and everything and finalize everything. And we get this message when we land, contact me immediately. And then he says, sorry guys, your song doesn't work. Can you write us a new one? The thing was, in typical Hollywood fashion, they put the movie out to a committee, you know, people...
Test audience, yes.
Basically. And the test audience all hated the end.
No. Specifically the teenage girls hated the ending. Because the original ending, the Molly Ringwald's character, Andy, ends up with her best friend, Ducky. That was the original storyline. And of course, all the girls who went, no, he's her friend, he's great, but she's got the love stories with Andrew McCartney, the pretty boy. So they had to reshoot the end of the movie, and we had specifically been asked to do the song for the big ending where it resolves at the prom, and lyrically, our song didn't make sense.
You're right. Said, you gotta be kidding, right? All our equipment has gone to San Francisco for the start of the tour. We've got no gear, we've got 2 days, and you want us to write a new song?
It was really strange because, you know, we had always written on synthesizers and then we'd moved to computers, and we didn't have that stuff. We were waiting for it to arrive from the hire company, but we had a deadline. We had a day to get this thing nailed. So Paul and I sat down like old-fashioned songwriters, him at the piano and me standing next to him, and he's just banging out chords.
Never done this before.
It was like totally alien. Now, this is the way everybody else writes, but not us. And we tried, and then the computer arrived, and our engineer was there because he was supposed to be mixing the other song. And we worked on it. We thought, well, this is working, it's okay. Finally, about 4 a.m,
we did a very rough demo.
We did a rough mix, put it on a cassette, sent it in a motorcycle to Paramount Studios, and we went to bed. And we remember, we're jet lagged as well. We'd only just landed, you know? And we were like, I'll do it. 9 a.m, phone rings, manager. Yeah, John's hurt. It's great, can you go back and finish it? We're like, oh God. So we went back in and we did the saxophone overdubs and a few more things. But If You Leave, totally written, off the top of our heads, desperate, and the biggest hit in America. One of the other, you know, strange things really about doing it was that, you know, for us, we were having to write a song that fitted in a movie and in a scene that was actually alien to us, because we don't have proms in the UK. Yeah. We don't have an end of high school prom. So, and also, and I'll let you into a secret now, there's a line in the song that doesn't make sense, because kids in England, you go from your junior school to your high school at the age of 11, and you're there for 7 years.
Oh my.
Not 4, you finish at 18, whereas in the States you kind of got junior, middle and high kind of thing, and it's the last 4 years in high school. So 7 years went under the bridge is actually a reference to English high school that doesn't make sense in the US actually.
7 years went under the bridge like time standing still.
Because we had such little time, when we were at the writing stage at the piano and Andy writing the words, we had this verse and chorus, and we got the chord change into the chorus, but we could never get back to the verse chordally, and I tried all these different things, and we were running out of time, and in the end I said, let's just keep changing key, because if you keep changing key, you can get the...
That's why the song modulates up and down and all over. We were trying to fit the pieces together and we didn't have time. It was just like, go up, go down, go... You know.
In hindsight, I mean, and when you listen to it now, you think, oh, that was all beautifully planned. But really, it was just getting out of a bit of a musical quandary.
And another thing, in the second verse, there's a little kind of like strange steel drum thing that goes diddle it, did it, diddle it, did it, which is a real hook there. That was supposed to be landing on the downbeat of the chorus. He programmed it wrong, and it came in off time, and we went, "Oh, yeah. Oh, that's great, actually." So again, another accident that gave it that.
There's a lot of happy accidents when you're writing songs. You know, you make mistakes that turn into it seemed like a great idea, but it was actually a happy accident.
So another couple of fun things that people might not know about it is we trimmed it down to 4:25. They said, we were amazed they wanted it as the lead single. We thought the Psychedelic First song would be the big one.
It seems to be the obvious one, Pretty in Pink, but yeah.
But so suddenly we had to kind of do, we had to get it ready, we had to do a single, we had to do a video, but they kept saying, nobody's going to play a song on radio that's longer than 4 minutes. And it's like, well, it's 5.5. So we were cutting.
We couldn't find a place to cut because it ruined it every time we did it.
We finally got it down to 4:25, and we just couldn't find another place to edit. So these are the days before digital. So we just wrote on the box 4:01. And it's 4:25 long, and we just lied about how long it was.
We just lied on the label. And no one said anything. It got played on the radio. Yeah.
The only parameter is it's got to be 120 beats per minute, because we filmed them dancing at the prom to Don't You Forget About Me, which is that tempo. So we were like, okay, that's the only parameter. So we wrote If You Leave at the same tempo as the previous song, 120, and when it was finally accepted, we went to the Hollywood program. We were all in the limos, red carpet, Chinese man's theatre. Of course, we're right at the end, so we sat there kind of like, going, yeah, the music's great, but come on, get to our bit, you know. And we finally get to the prom scene. Oh, and we went, hang on a minute, who edited this? Nobody's dancing on the beat. The tempo doesn't matter, and for 5 minutes everybody's dancing off the beat. We're like,
I don't think they fixed that in the end.
The other great thing about having If You Leave in our back pocket when we're in America is it's like playing poker, and you know you've got four aces, because when that drum fill comes in at the front, it's just like going,
people go nuts.
There you go, win in hand. Crowd go crazy. It is, it's like sitting there with four aces in your hand. It's great. Some people get stupid about their big hit,
and they go, oh, I'm so bored of it, I played it thousands of times.
And they don't play it live, or they play a boring acoustic version of it to be different live.
Yeah. Why?
We're proud of our hits.
That is awesome.
You know. We're proud of our hits.
That song has been good to you, so treat it with respect, and also treat the audience with respect. It's part of their journey of life, their memory, so don't screw around with it. Well, the success of If You Leave certainly opened doors for us. Strangely enough, in all of the countries where we hadn't had much success previously, obviously the US, Australia, places like that, South Africa, and yet it seemed to close doors in places where we'd been successful previously. For example, weird. If You Leave didn't even make the top 50 in the UK.
Isn't that odd?
Yeah, it's very odd.
So it's, but you know what? When you're driving around LA and on comes your song on the radio and you go, oh, comedy boredom, I'll change the channel. Oh, it's on another station. Oh, it's on another, that's when you know you've cracked it.
Absolutely. Again, it was just a privilege talking to those guys. I mean, they were a couple of nicest guys in the world, and we didn't really, I mean, we actually tried to talk to a bunch of other bands, and they weren't quite as willing. But these guys were just wonderful.
They're a great live band.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and like I say, they were just here a couple of weeks ago at Red Butte, and they gave us free tickets because we couldn't afford their concert up there at Red Butte. But yeah, we went up there and saw them again, and they are just outstanding in concert. If you ever have a chance, you really need to see them.
Before we move on from Pretty in Pink, can I interject something?
Yeah, absolutely.
I just went back and watched the movie within the last week again, and I had totally forgotten that the scene towards the end of the movie where Andy's making her own homemade prom dress, New Order's, an instrumental version of New Order's Thieves Like Us, which is one of my favorite New Order
songs,
was playing while she was making her dress. Well, I ended up watching the supplemental features on the DVD, and there was an interview with Howard Deutsch, is that how you pronounce his name?
The director.
The director of the movie. And he was talking about how he had this intention to have this big epic score in the movie, and then John Hughes went to him and said, no, no, the music that we pick for this movie is every bit as important as the characters are. And so John Hughes actually had to take Howard aside and introduce him to some of the bands, New Order being one of them, and that's, I think, how they ended up with two songs in the group, or in the movie. But it was a testament of how important those songs are in these movies.
Oh, good insight. So, kind of moved to the lesser version of Pretty in Pink. Some Kind of Wonderful.
Which I still like quite a bit. But
which seems to have the original ending of Pretty in Pink incorporated into it.
Yeah, that's the original one, too. But again, like most Hughes, the soundtrack was kind of slim pickings. This one was not as commercially successful, both theatrically and soundtrack-wise, as Pretty in Pink.
You know, I look over the songs on it, and as I said to Steve and Sean, that it's really it's really Hughes's indie soundtrack. I mean, it has some bands on there like Furniture, The Apartment. What's that? Yeah, go ahead and hit that. Like the Tins, Propaganda, March Violets. I mean, these were bands that really didn't do a lot. Propaganda did a little bit more than some of the others, but they were very much of an indie kind of soundtrack. And I absolutely love the soundtrack. It has some amazing songs on it.
This one is probably the biggest hit,
the biggest hit on the album, or the soundtrack.
Again, kind of great soundtrack, but definitely the lesser known. One of the other bands that we talked to earlier was also Dave Wakeling of the English Beat, General Public. Didn't realize how much of a hand he had in the John Hughes movies. We interviewed him, can't really play it because it went on for about an hour and a half, and he's got a thick accent. So just kind of some highlights he shared is one that John Hughes never really wanted to be a filmmaker, he wanted to be a musician in a band. But he wasn't as talented as most. He had a wealth of knowledge. Dave became almost a soundtrack producer for Ferris Bueller's Day Off, which is probably Hughes's biggest teen flick, or his swan song to the teenage years. Dave Wakeling and the English Beat, they had the big March of the Swivel Heads, the big music number, the chase scene at the end. One thing surprisingly though for Ferris Bueller, how many people own that soundtrack? There is no soundtrack.
There is no soundtrack. There wasn't.
John Hughes put out a double-sided 7-inch to what he called his fan club. Anybody that wrote Hughes, he would keep their address on file, send them things when their movies would come out. So they pressed a 7-inch single that had Beat City and I'm Afraid by Blue Room on it. Yeah. So
there was actually no soundtrack to Ferris Bueller's Day Off originally, and which is shocking considering how many good songs are in that soundtrack.
So just due to time, I'm going to skip some of the songs on the soundtrack.
We're out of time.
But they actually, for the 30th anniversary, there was a group called La La Land Records that actually did put out a Ferris Bueller soundtrack. However, it's missing two songs. One of them being Twist and Shout by the Beatles. They couldn't get the rights to, and also the March of the Swivel Heads by the English Beat. The myths going around, there's really no one can say for sure why they didn't put an official album out. It's one even at the end of the movie, it says soundtrack available on A&M Records. Hughes felt that no kids are going to want a soundtrack that had anything from Oh Yeah to Donka Shane to Twist and Shout.
It has a really eclectic number of songs on it, along with some just great new wave songs.
So part of our preparation interviewing Dave Wakeling, we also interviewed one of the record executives from La La Land Records. One of the myths going around was the biggest thing is John Hughes is a big music fan. When the movie came out, he was a huge Beatles fan as well. Rumor is Paul McCartney heard the version of Twist and Shout with the brass horns and flipped out about it. Hughes was a little devastated and kind of made the decision not to put out the soundtrack. Dave Wakeling, when he was working on She's Having a Baby, he was the soundtrack producer, was trying to convince him to do a double album. One of She's Having a Baby, one of Ferris Bueller. He declined. Again, for the 30th anniversary of this movie, the La La Land Records got the rights to most everything except for the Beatles and Dave Wakeling. He declined to release his song onto it as he felt that that was what Hughes' wish would be. He did also then after find out one of Hughes' children was behind making the soundtrack, and he regrets not adding it on there. But as Ferris says, if you have the means, I definitely recommend picking one up.
Or winning one.
So, and then just real quick towards the end here, we've got our last, probably the more adult John Hughes one. Had a great soundtrack, but it was not...
It was a flop.
It was a box office flop.
Yeah.
But the soundtrack had a lot of memorable...
Amazing soundtrack.
So, I mean, it had everything from Love and Rockets throughout it, which was probably one of their... underrated.
There's a lot of haunting, I mean, beyond just no pun, the song Haunted, but it's a very haunting soundtrack. It's very emotional. While Steve does this, I want to give out the rest of the tickets. So if you did not get a ticket for the giveaway, put your hand up.
So again, Brian Ferry this time was offered a John Hughes movie soundtrack, and he added to it. So. The soundtrack also features one of the bands that seems to come to Utah almost regularly, is Gene Loves Jezebel, Desire, and that scene that song's playing is kind of sums up that song. The nightclub scene in She's Having a Baby.
Lyrically, it really, really worked with this scene. For sure. That's the one thing I loved about this movie as an adult, is it deals with the adult themes that we couldn't connect with as teenagers, but there's so much that's poignant to our lives as adults.
One of the other songs on here also featured probably one of their bigger hits was Everything But the Girl, Apron Strings. So it kind of shows that soundtrack kind of goes all over the place, but ties together really well. Which also led into the biggest one on the soundtrack was Kate Bush.
I love this song.
This woman's work. She heard about the movie, took it, wrote the song for the movie, and part of it is because she knew she did. Everyone kind of seems to write songs for John Hughes movies. It turns into a hit, and this is probably arguably her biggest number that's playing during the climax at the end.
Give me that little kiss.
this song is particularly poignant for me. My oldest daughter, when she was born, ended up being Breech, as the baby in this movie is, and we ended up having to have a C-section with her. Now, while my experience was not nearly as dramatic as what's going on here, the song was playing in my head the entire time.
So I think this movie kind of does wrap up going from the teenage years to the mysteries of getting married, having kids, and
more serious,
jumping into an adult. But
this is one of those scenes and one of those songs where it really defines what people are too callous to show any emotion, because it's a very, very emotional scene. Lots of tears for lots of people.
Okay. All right, that pretty much wraps it up, so let's give some stuff away.